Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mothers, Daughters, and Body Image, Learning to Love Ourselves as We Are, by Hilary L. McBride. Foreword by Ramani Durvasala, Ph.D. Narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Moment 1. First moments, the merging of two cells into one, multiplying 2, 4, 6, 8, rapidly growing and forming the information that will decide my hair, eyes, teeth, hands, my genetic DNA. Everything I needed to become a human, and still I am invisible to the naked eye. I am grown from my mother's own body, my blood from her blood, my heartbeat from her choice, making her belly swell and her hormones go crazy with rage and want for whipped cream-filled donuts at 4 a.m. My body grows, and she puts her hand upon her belly to feel a foot kick her side, the jerk of hiccups, the round of my head. She is proud, proud of her body that is a force, source of life to mine. I grow. Her body tells her it is time. I come into the world with pain and euphoria as she breaks her beautiful body to give me life. She sees me for the first time, what she has made, and it is good. The intricacies of the human body is something staggering. Veins, heart, lungs, synapses, toenails, chemicals, eyelashes, all good and beautiful. She holds my body and breathes in. I grow. From a baby to a toddler, toddler to little girl, I am 4 and I can run around with my shirt off and feel the fullness of the wind. I can paint my belly and take baths with my friends, slap my butt and laugh. We sleep under the stars and run through sprinklers naked and wild. We are silly and think our bodies are strange and wonderful. I grow and I am 6. I am taught what I can and cannot do with my body. Can no longer take my shirt off outside on my front porch, no longer run around naked with my friends outside with paint on our bellies because the man across the street stares, so my mother takes me inside and tells me I am now the age where I need to be careful. A feeling comes I never knew before. I learn later the word for it is this: shame. We are at our friend's house, and the teenage boy keeps making me sit on his lap. I don't understand it. We are all sitting in a circle, about 10 of us, and no one notices. I am confused and try to get away from him, but he holds me there and moves his hands in a way I don't understand. I feel I should obey because he is a strong, older boy, and I, a small girl, inherently weaker than he. I get mad that my body is not stronger, that I cannot break free. I feel it is my fault. Maybe I should not have worn shorts, so my legs were covered. And then there was the church leader, my friend's father, who insisted he put lotion on my legs after our bath. I didn't want him to, but he made me obey because he was a man and I, young and born the lesser of the sexes. It is uncomfortable, and I thought he must not know what he is doing. A respectable man, let alone a church leader, wouldn't do this. But now I am older and know better. Yes, he knew. So I am 6, and I can no longer be free in this body I once ran wild in, but I should cover it because there are predators, and I don't tell because I am ashamed, and it was no big deal, no reason to fuss. I am 14. I feel my body changing on me, I notice and others notice, and I no longer have the freedom of my youth. Blood comes and I am embarrassed. Hiding the grocery store runs, keeping it a secret, seeing my brother laugh when he looks under the sink. It is a wonder of growing to womanhood, but I am starting to hate being a woman. I am ashamed at what my body does. This beautiful thing that I once ran free in is turning on me, making me awkward and uncomfortable because even you are now uncomfortable with that thought. Boys' eyes consume rather than see. I am told this is my fault. I am told God wants me to cover my body, wear longer skirts and shirts up to my collarbone, and be sure it isn't tight. But how much skin is okay? Because other girls cover their whole body in black, and I heard of the day there were two separate staircases for males and females so that males wouldn't accidentally catch a glimpse of a girl's ankle. Now that I am 14, now that I am changing, is God now ashamed with what he made? The body formed in my mother, so good and beautiful, turned to shame with age and religious threads weaving and constructing my social identity. Oppression for something I cannot control, something completely natural and good. If this body is not holy in and of itself, then God should have never made it in the first place. It's the flower hating its vibrant petals, the beautiful tree sprouting from the earth only to grow and be ashamed of its bark. I am 20. I have rejected the shy, awkward aspects of womanhood and instead learned to joke about it to cope and be cool. But when night comes, I am often afraid to walk down the street alone. Every walk I take is accompanied with fear because I see the eyes consume. I hear the threats and am followed. I have friends who are victims. Every girl I know has been afraid, every one of them, from taking a simple walk to rape and a child coming from it. One hid in the laundry basket when she was 9. One silently prayed every night from 13 to 16 that her father would be too drunk to come into her bed. One was at a party with her friend. He wanted something, but she didn't, so he trapped her in the restroom. One hid from her brother, another from her grandfather, another from her coworker. Some say it is the woman's fault. The shirt was too low, breasts too big. How can a man resist? But here's a staggering idea. Maybe the victim isn't at fault. If in looking at the beautiful woman's body, you cannot appreciate her beauty but must strip and consume, then it is true. Our culture has poisoned your mind. Consume, take, be the animal, take, take, take. Shame. Did my mother think that when she held me close to her chest at my birth? Was she ashamed? The beautiful form becomes forbidden and lusted at a certain age, all held together by a story of a serpent and a woman. Though some claim the curse is broken, some still believe it. The body is shamed, curse ever present. I am 30. I made two girls within my own body, felt the rush of bringing them into the world, and when I saw their bodies, I saw a miracle. Their skin and eyelashes, perfect. Tiny lips, tiny fingernails, eyes embodying innocence and awe. They grow and run around my house naked and scream wildly without self-awareness or social concern. I teach them about our culture and what is and isn't acceptable, but what I will not teach them is the shame of their body. It was beautiful from moment one, and that will not change, not with age, not with anything. One daughter looks at her body in the mirror, and we talk about the organs and skin, how her body will change. She is beautiful on every count. I remember when I was 6, and I know I have to warn her, not shame her, but tell her how some people were not taught to love, but take for themselves, and she must be brave and aware. It pains me as I tell her, her innocent mind not know why one person would hurt another in such a way. Do not be afraid, I tell her, but this is our culture, so be smart and be aware, my brave girl. Shame teaches us, but I will not teach my daughters in this way. I will empower them to be proud of their bodies, respectful of their bodies, in awe of how miraculous it is and what it is capable of. I will tell my daughter that to be a woman is not to be lesser, not object, not the bed in the red light district, nor the bitch in the hotel. She is not the body to exploit or product to consume. She is not shame. She is beautiful woman with beautiful body, capable of cosmic realities. Holding someone close, experiencing love, making love, creating life, accepting another human life as her own, feeling pain, joy, giving strength, healing with a kiss, wholeness with a touch, giving physical and mental nourishment with her own body. She is grounded enough to follow, still capable to lead from a child to a nation. The woman's body is made in the image of love, from love herself, life herself, so she herself is of God. For my grandmother, for my mother, for my daughters, my friends, and as a reminder to myself, be proud, beautiful woman. Your body is intrinsically good, perfectly good. Perfect from moment one. Lisa Gunger, GungerMusic.com. Forward. Does this make me look fat? A reflexive mantra issued by most women while contorting in front of a mirror. Most of us are guilty of it, uttering it in front of friends, sisters, retail clerks, a sisterhood of co-conspirators, all of them assuaging us, feeling the same way. And those of us who are mothers know we have said this in front of our daughters, grimacing once we catch ourselves. A daughter watching in rapt attention as mommy dresses for work, a night out, or even pulling on her grocery store sweats. And as with everything else we say and do, they absorb it, and it subtly crafts their developing selves. Upward of 90% of American women are dissatisfied with their bodies. That's a statistic that implies basically every woman in America experiences some level of body dissatisfaction. Where does it come from? All of us are sociologically plugged in enough to know that our perceptions have been altered by the impossible imagery and shaming media. Magazine covers screaming out at us about our abs and our flab, and fetishizing women who gave birth 2 weeks prior and are back in their skinny jeans. 7-year-olds now know how to use photo editing tools to alter their own images and manipulate themselves into a smaller version of themselves. But the media is a convenient and perhaps all too simple scapegoat. As you are about to discover through the stories of the women you will hear, as well as Hillary's story, these narratives go far deeper. They are deeper tales of dissatisfaction, regret, and fear. They are intergenerationally transmitted, like family fairy tales, but these stories also remind us that our narratives are not destiny, that these cycles can be broken, and ultimately they can become tales of empathy, redemption, and love. I had the pleasure of talking with Hillary about her ideas a few years ago during a chance meeting in Ottawa in a workshop for women in psychology at the Canadian Psychological Association conference. Weight management has been a pivot point in my clinical and research work for years. I have worked with clients who struggle with obesity, disordered eating, and body image distortion. My experience in this space culminated in my first book, but where I learned the most about the importance of narrative on body image was my personal story of weight loss. Much like Hillary, who discovered the nuance of this topic through the brave telling of her own lived experience, it is the miles that we walk ourselves that are often most revelatory. In fact, my legitimacy to my clients did not come from the PhD or the professorship, but rather the fact that I lost 85 pounds and had before and after pictures to show for it. I personally recognized that health was not just about addressing behaviors and habits, but also to look hard at the narratives that shape our health and our habits. This wasn't about protein instead of pastries or hours in the gym. This was about recrafting my narrative and the recognition that health, weight, eating, and body image are an evolving narrative for all women. Then one day, it became really personal. When my tween daughter started fretting about body image issues in recent years, my blood chilled. My reflexive, defensive maneuver was to blame social media, films, TV, Los Angeles. And then I blamed myself. I sifted through the messages I may have given her. Did she see me vexed over an ill-fitting dress or ruminating about a slice of cheesecake? Or did I let slip a, does this make me look fat? Because of the nature of my work, I thought I was a relentlessly mindful mother about healthy food, healthy body talk, and regularly taking the time to educate my daughters on how to critically think about the overly sexualized images in the media. Do I turn her into a neo-Luddite and dismiss the phone, the social media, the television? Or do I dig deeper into me and reach for one of the ladders Hillary writes about to find a new way to have the conversation about body image, a conversation that fits for both my daughters and me? A conversation that takes into account our specific stories, our body shapes, our body types, our lifestyles, our narratives. We live in the age of simple solutions. People want quick fixes and simple palliatives, life advice in 140 characters or less. We want our weight loss advice to be easy and prescriptive. Eat this, not that. One size fits all advice. We want to teach girls to be comfortable with their body image against the backdrop of a photoshopped world, the worship of the ectomorphic, and their mother's own weight and body fears. But each and every one of us is born into a different family, bringing different stories that shape us and different body types, and that subsequently shape the worlds of our children. Rare is the parent who does not want better for her child. Every one of us is aware of the vulnerabilities engendered by our own childhoods, and we vow that we will not repeat those mistakes. We are capable of retelling our stories. But with each generation, new vulnerabilities arise, and so too does the aesthetic of a society. Narratives and zeitgeists about body shape and weight may shift with times, but perhaps our primitive narratives of beauty and being enough are ancient stories that lie at the core of these conflicts. In conducting therapy about weight loss with my clients, if I have learned only one thing, it is that long-time struggles with body image and weight loss are rarely about carbs and runway models. These are complex stories about old hurts, ancient scripts, and sometimes past traumas. Distortions of body image and discontrolled eating are not simply manifestations of media manipulations or poor willpower, but old narratives that have become so well-worn they feel like a person's identity. Before my clients know it, the food diaries and exercise goals become conversations about long-ago meals at childhood dinner tables, observations of their mother's regrets, and ultimately, letting go of old schemas and personal constructions. Hillary's book highlights the passing down of these old stories, but also how the transformational arc of becoming a parent can force someone to confront these demons in an attempt to avoid passing them down like a dysfunctional familial relic. The next generation can choose to reject these old narratives and perhaps school their own parents in how to think differently about health and self-value. We often presume that the body image story is top-down, parent teaching child to love her body. But Hillary's book also teaches us that it may be far more reciprocal. Yes, we as parents are the original teachers and face the responsibilities of teaching our children the fundamentals of healthy nutrition, exercise, and self-care, in addition to the big-ticket psychological scaffolds of attachment, self-regulation, and compassion. But the larger lessons of self-love, authenticity, confidence, and constancy can be quite reciprocal. As our children grow, we are made to face our own fears as parents. The arena in which most of us learn unconditional love happens when we become parents. It may finally be the voices of our children that teach us that we are more than enough, and in turn to accept ourselves and live in a way that models unconditional love, not just for others, but also toward ourselves. Our deepest hope must be that this lesson of unconditional love and self-acceptance is paid forward for our bodies, minds, and lives. our narratives are not fixed in stone. They can be re-rendered and revisited. Acceptance is rarely about perfection. It is about compassion. And that may be the most important health message of all. And perhaps the whole enterprise is better shared in poetry. I am larger, better than I thought. I did not know I held so much goodness. All seems beautiful to me. Whoever denies me, it shall not trouble me. Whoever accepts me, he or she shall be blessed and shall bless me. Walt Whitman. Dr. Ramani Dervasala, Los Angeles, California. 1. A Daughter's Letter. Re-examine all you have been told, and your very flesh shall be a great poem and have the richest fluency not only in its words, but in the silent lines of its lips and face and between the lashes of your eyes and in every motion and joint of your body. Walt Whitman. I never blamed my mother for my struggle with an eating disorder, although I had many opportunities. In some ways, that would have been the easiest thing to do, to put the responsibility for my pain onto someone else as a way of making sense of it all. In the mother-blaming world we live in, it may or may not be hard to believe, but people often encouraged me to blame my mom. This came out in the subtle and not-so-subtle ways that people pressed for an answer to questions of why. Why was I suffering? It would have been particularly easy when I was the most ill, or in years of therapy working towards recovery, or even now as a therapist and researcher trying to make sense of how body image takes shape in women. There is something human about wanting to make sense of pain, of the ugly and messy things in life. I think it makes us feel like we have more control than we do, and if we just knew enough, we could change it for someone else, for ourselves, for the world. Or, if it's someone else's fault, we are off the hook, and we don't have to examine thoughtfully, painfully, our role in the origin or expression of the suffering. If I press myself to really think and confess, there were moments when I wanted to, or tried to, blame my mother. But these moments were a long time ago and didn't usually last for more than a few seconds of frustration, confusion, or desperation, wanting someone else to clean up the mess that it felt like my life had become. I just wanted so badly to feel like how I got there, why I was struggling, was someone else's fault. I didn't believe it was entirely my own, but if not mine, then whose? But the more I thought about it, it didn't make sense to me to put all the responsibility for my pain on her shoulders when I wouldn't put all the glory for my recovery on her either. Something about that equation didn't make sense. Plus, I couldn't fight the thing that has never felt most true, the thing that has always been most certain for me in my entire life— that my mother loves me more than anything. She wants the best for me and wants even more for me than she has ever wanted for herself. When we as therapists and researchers who study body image start to look at understanding young girls' and women's body image problems, it becomes a game of pointing the finger. Surely a struggle which almost every woman experiences must be related to the other experience most women know, having a mother. Finding the space between blaming mothers and understanding the absolutely sacred and essential role they have in raising their daughters is like walking a very delicate tightrope suspended between two impossibly tall buildings. Balance is everything. Mothers are the most dynamic and influential force on the development of a young woman's journey to being herself. This will ultimately be one of the most defining relationships of her life and probably her first real encounter with love. And this sacred relationship will most likely also be her first deep encounter with struggle and pain, as a daughter learns to push against her mother to find out who she is as an individual. The problem is that the story often ends there, when there is really so much more than the pushing away, blaming, and hurt. Mothers have the power to be the most important person in helping their daughters know freedom, voice, depth, beauty, power, and safety. Most of us have spent our entire lives learning about, then perfecting, the performance of the role of the good woman. We have learned that as a woman, it is best to be quiet, to be sweet, small, and compliant, and to keep working on the project of our bodies to make them look more and more desirable. Even though I've made peace with my story and the road it took to get where I am now, there are still a few things I can't and refuse to let go of. As women, rarely do we know what it looks, feels, or sounds like to ourselves as we are. I've worked hard to piece together stories and relationships in my own life that have helped me have something, a vision, a narrative, of what it means to be a woman in this world. I have met several women and am blessed to have deep friendships with women who love their bodies and themselves as they are. They are the proof of victory, the beacon of hope for myself and for other women, but their experiences aren't the normal experiences for most women. In fact, whenever I talk about women loving their bodies, most teen and adult women say, "That's not possible," or "That's not the whole truth." These responses identify the problem that I can't and won't let go of. If, as women, we don't believe it's possible to love our bodies as they are, how are we going to find the courage to carve that path on our own? How can we work for and build something we don't believe can exist? How can we love ourselves, our bodies, and each other as we are? What went right? We don't hear very often the stories when it comes to women's relationships to their bodies when things go right, and what happened along the way that helped these women get there. This is true both in the public, think news, print media, and social media, and in academic and therapeutic settings. In psychology, we have had a long history of researching people who have mental illness, not mental health. I have heard countless stories of women, as a therapist, researcher, and friend, who've come back from a vicious battle with body shame and won. Yet, I started to wonder, what happens when women skip that "I hate my body and want to cut off my thighs" phase and jump right to the "I don't look like women in magazines and shouldn't, and love myself just as I am" phase? And what might mothers have to do with all of that? I can make it sound like I was trying all along to write the book you hold within your hands. The truth is that the research I've done for this book was because I had some questions I wanted to ask, motivated by my own deep fear. I desperately wanted to understand how to help a daughter love her body right from the get-go, because I want to have a daughter one day. And I want to know I did everything I could, in spite of my own wounds, to give her the best shot that I can in this confusing, mysterious, wonderful, and often painful world. I want to do everything I can to protect her and every other woman from struggling in the same way I did. So, I set out to find a group of young women who had never had an eating disorder and really, truly, deep down loved themselves. I wanted to hear their stories of struggle and strength, and I was deeply curious to learn what their mothers did and didn't do so that I could learn from their wisdom. In the process, I was transformed in more ways than I could have imagined. I started talking about what I was finding out in the research to my friends, my clients, other researchers and academics, and women everywhere wanted to talk about it too. And they didn't want just the abbreviated version. They wanted the real stories, the honest words, the hopeful truths. It turns out that as women, there is a lot of us who want to know that there is another way to live besides being constantly bombarded with thoughts about how bad you look and how ashamed you are of your body. It also turns out that the things I found out from these young women and their mothers hadn't been talked about before. The more we talked about it with each other and shared our insights with other women, we started to believe as women that another way was really possible. But we can't do it alone, and I don't believe we were ever meant to. In fact, what was so unique about the story of the development of these women's healthy body image was the role that relationship played in it all. That's where the mother part comes in. If mothers really are as influential as we say they are, then they have the potential, through relationship with their daughters, to protect their daughters, to fight for them, to create a new world for them, and give them freedom, not just baggage. The best news of all is that this can happen even when mothers are still struggling in their own journey to love their bodies. That means that no matter where you are right now in your life, in your struggle to fight with or love your body, you can be part of creating change for the women who are coming after you. And you don't have to stop it there. By being part of a movement to help all women, and your daughter if you have one, love themselves in their bodies, you'll start to experience this for yourself too. This is, for me and most other women who heard this, the most liberating part of what you're going to be hearing. You don't have to be perfect to help change things in your daughter's life, in your community, and in the world. In fact, what the world of young and not-so-young women needs is to see other women who, in spite of being imperfect, are a powerful force to be reckoned with. In the process of doing all the work of finding these amazing women and hearing their stories, I knew that I was going to look at ways my mother had shaped me. I would have to acknowledge all the ways she had helped me become me. This meant looking past all the stuff I don't like that I inherited from her. These were and still are my mother's greatest gifts to me, her love, the opportunity to let me think for myself even when it hurt her, and the tenacious spirit to fight for justice. No woman is perfect. No mother is perfect. But we each have something very special to offer each other. I hope that in listening to this book, you will be inspired to notice and share these gifts with your daughter and the other women around you. This is not the kind of inspired in the "I have jeans two sizes too small in my closet" sense of the word, but in its truest form. That you believe that it's possible as girls and women, as daughters and mothers, to love ourselves just as we are. 2. The ladder out, standing on her shoulders. I once dreamt I was telling stories and felt someone patting my foot in encouragement. I looked down and saw that I was standing on the shoulders of an older woman who was steadying my ankles and smiling up at me. I said to her, "No, no, come, stand on my shoulders, for you are old and I am young." "No, no," she insisted, "this is the way it is supposed to be." I saw that she stood on the shoulders of a woman far older than she, who stood on the shoulders of a woman even older, who stood on the shoulders of a woman in robes, who stood on the shoulders of another soul, who stood on the shoulders. Clarissa Pinkola Estes, Women Who Run with the Wolves. It happened today, again. I have these moments every so often when I realize with simultaneous amusement and terror that I am becoming my mother. I was late for an important meeting, sitting at a standstill in traffic on a busy highway, with apparently nothing to do but become awakened to the subconscious patterns of my family of origin. There is this thing that my mom always has done. In her car, she sets the clock 15 minutes ahead to help herself get somewhere on time. The thing that happens when she does this, though, is that she always remembers that the clock is 15 minutes fast, so the trick doesn't work and she gets places at the same time she always would. In my adulthood, I've realized my own version of the car clock trick. My watch is usually fast by 5 minutes. And today, as I was sitting in my car, nowhere near the destination I was supposed to be 5 minutes earlier, I realized I had fallen for the same trick. In no way had setting my watch a few minutes faster gotten me out of the house earlier than I would have normally. I just look at my watch, knowing it's fast, and think, I've got time. Gasp. No one was twisting my arm. It was me who did this. I've had more experiences with this too, making big batches of soup on Sundays for meals in the coming week, carrying too many bags from the car so I only have to make one trip, assembling the same kind of tomato sandwich in the exact same way that she does when I need a meal in a pinch, and so many more. As it turns out, there is a word for this fear. Matrophobia. That is the official word for the dread of becoming one's mother. After laughing with delight at the word itself, I took comfort in knowing that this was something so common there is actually a word for it. It is normal, if not entirely universal, fear that we will one day become our mothers. We can adore them, appreciate their generosity and unconditional love, and still be struck with terror at realizing that our efforts to push against their annoying idiosyncrasies to be a totally different and unique person were futile, and we are more alike than not. This is one of the fears I hear from mothers most when they're coming in for therapy. It doesn't usually come out right away, but at some point in the process of doing therapy, a woman will want to do some work about how to be different than her mother. Not just her fear of taking on her mother's little mannerisms, but of hurting her children, her daughter, in the way her mother hurt her or let her down. All the drops count. Even though all our stories as women are different, we all have a story of how we became who we are. And whether we like it or not, that story is usually shaped at least in some ways by our mother, whether she was physically or emotionally present or not. This may feel scary to think about, both as you think about who you are and who your daughter may become, but I want to remind you that no matter what anyone says, life isn't as deterministic as we are often told. What we think and want and do matters. We are not just the sum of the mistakes that our mothers made or the mistakes we have made up until this moment. Who we are in this moment and who we are working to become also counts for something. We and our daughters can be more than our accidents, mess-ups, and fears. At a certain moment in our lives, we get the opportunity to make some choices about what we do with that story of how we became the self we are today. Having a daughter is special, in that you get opportunities every day to make those choices. There are the big moments, like the screaming at each other fight, where it seems easy to identify that in that moment you can do something different than your mother might have done for you. But we forget that there are also hundreds of little moments that make up our day when we can make small choices to do something differently than how our mothers before us did. Those small moments, like how you respond when your child walks in the door after school, when she asks for a snack, or what you say about something that to you might seem insignificant, but to her might mean the world. When we add up all those millions of small moments, they amount to so much more. Think of these moments like making very small but regular deposits into a savings account. You likely won't notice that a few dollars have been put away, but pretty soon it's added up to something much bigger. I usually see this going one of two ways, staying stuck or something I'll call choosing the latter. When we are stuck, as individuals or as parents, we recreate the patterns we experienced with our mother internally and in our relationships with others, especially our daughters. This often happens when a mom is afraid to examine these patterns or unaware that they exist, and so unknowingly relives them, not ever knowing or working towards another way of being. Most of us fall into this category, even though we may desperately want more for ourselves and for our daughters than anyone will ever know. And this isn't because we are bad or weak or unlovable. But sometimes looking backwards, then moving forwards, is a demanding, difficult, and terrifying thing to do. The other option, Choosing the latter is what we saw in the mothers and daughters in this study. The latter these mothers chose, or what we called in the study, standing on my shoulders, was our way of saying that the mother could identify and name the negative cycles she had with her own mother and took deliberate steps to do things differently in her own life and for her daughter. This didn't mean she was perfect or did it flawlessly every time, but she wasn't pretending those patterns weren't there and was passionate about protecting her daughter from her own struggles. In doing so, she offered her daughter a ladder out of her own struggles as woman into a bigger, brighter, freer world. Although they never expected this, the mothers in the study were transformed in the process of helping to transform their girls. They felt there was meaning in their efforts, and that it was healing for them in their own story to know they broke a cycle that could have gone on indefinitely. What was really special about these moms was that they didn't just try and protect their daughters from the painful mother-daughter relationship wounds, but also from their own individual struggles, like anxiety, depression, or shame. These mothers were able to look at their lives with honesty and courage and name the things that they had struggled with most. Then they worked hard, in small and big ways, to try to create the opposite experience for their daughters. For example, one of the mothers, Cherie, who you'll meet in a later chapter, has struggled a lot with anxiety. It had shown up in her life in a variety of ways, some more subtle, others more overwhelming and disabling. She actually carried a lot of shame about her struggles at first, but instead of hiding her struggles or ignoring that anxiety existed in life, she decided she wanted to talk openly with her daughter about anxiety in general and reminded all of her kids it was okay to share their feelings with her. Cherie wanted her daughter to know that if she was anxious, she could tell her mother about it and that she wouldn't be alone. Anne's story. This is where I want to introduce some of the women we studied, Kelsey and her mother Anne, to explain more about how all of the things I'm talking about look in real life. My hope with this is that the ideas I'm talking about will start to come to life and feel more within your reach. I hope you learn from these women in ways that I did, and that you're surprised by how much more you have to offer the world, your daughter, than you originally thought. Meet Anne. Anne is the middle-aged mother of three who is tall and has a strong voice and deep laugh. I met Anne because her daughter Kelsey was participating in the study. I knew Kelsey loved her body and all other parts of herself. That was assessed quantitatively and qualitatively for inclusion in this specific study. I wanted to know how Anne helped Kelsey love her body and what she did and didn't do to help Kelsey grow up to be strong, confident, and beautiful all at the same time. When Anne speaks about her experience of growing up, the story is one of insecurity, pain, and silence. She talked about being insecure because she was taller than other kids her age and noticing early on that she was different from them because of her height. In our interview, she called her younger self an ugly duckling, which was a name she was called as a kid. In spite of this, she describes experiencing some of her own physical and mental strength early on through playing sports. Playing on many sports teams as a child helped her feel strong and healthy, and being on a team gave her the chance to feel like she belonged. Although playing sports was helpful, it wasn't enough to help her overcome her insecurity in her appearance, an insecurity that runs from early in her childhood into how she still sees herself now. Although the things that made her insecure as a kid are now gone, age and menopause have come with new challenges that make her feel at odds with her body. She says she's put on more weight and that her body isn't cooperating the way it used to. Although we were just meeting for the first time when I interviewed her, Anne was quite free with how she spoke about herself. She was really honest with how things were in the past and how they are now. Despite the struggles she's having with her appearance now, she says she wants to work on how she feels about herself, about her body. She says about her self-image, "I think it could improve. I think that I need to work a little harder on accepting myself where I am right now, instead of going, ugh, when I look at myself in the mirror. When listening to Anne speak, this was my first moment of hope about what I can bring to the world and a future daughter. Her daughter Kelsey was thriving and confident in herself, which had happened even though Anne still considered her journey of self-acceptance to be a work in progress. What she did do was offer her daughters a ladder. She was aware of how dissatisfied she was with her own body and wanted to instill in her three daughters that they were beautiful, something she never heard from her own mom. I was so struck by Anne's self-awareness and self-compassion. She realized that she didn't love her body as much as she could, and she realized that was something she wanted to work on. But she didn't beat herself up about the things she didn't do perfectly. She had a comfortable way of saying that she was working towards loving herself more. Her relationship with her body reminds me of how so many people I know describe their relationships with their partners. They are able to describe that they love the other person in their imperfections and want to keep working on building the closeness and affection in their relationship, but they also realize it takes time. This all makes me think about what would happen if I was able to love myself, my body, the parts, and the whole, in the way that I love other people. What if, as women, we could dedicate ourselves to practice kindness and care towards ourselves in the way that we are often so good at being kind and caring to those around us? Anne's desire to give her daughters a ladder showed up in many dimensions of their relationships, not just in what she told them about their appearances. She was courageous to believe in and then act on the desire to be a better mother to her daughters than her mother was to her. In order to better understand what that meant, I asked her to describe what her relationship with her mom was like growing up. She was quiet for a long time and then said, "With my mother, it was not a close relationship at all. My mom had a very difficult life. My mom, consequently, was very silent and withdrawn. She was just trying to cope, and so we never talked about feelings or thoughts or anything like that. She was kind to me, but it was never more than that." Listening to Anne's story reveals how what we say is often just as important as what we don't say. We can communicate literally about bodies and say things to other people like, "Women's bodies are so attractive when they are thin or young." Or we can communicate about women's bodies by what we don't say. The silence on certain issues, especially if they are intentionally avoided or dismissed, can communicate to others, "This isn't important," or, "We don't talk about sex or bodies in our family." Anne says that her mom never spoke to her about bodies, sexuality, or beauty, but instead was focused more on doing tasks and keeping the house running. Unlike Anne's mom, who was emotionally absent but kind, Anne's dad was abusive towards her in several ways. Anne never told her mother about the abuse. When I asked her about this now, she said that she thinks she was trying to protect her mom from hurting more in her life. When she was saying this, she paused, took a breath, and said in a very matter-of-fact way, "I think deep down I knew that my mom would not do what I needed her to, and I think I was trying to protect myself from being totally crushed by that." She found out when she was older that her intuition during those difficult years was right. When she told her mom about it years later, she found out that her mother knew all along but never did anything. She courageously confronted her mother about this and said that her mother had no good reason for not sticking up for Anne. When I asked her how this shaped her, she said that all of what she has been through, both the abuse from her dad and knowing that her mother couldn't defend her, made it very hard for her to love and accept herself. That because of this, from early on, she worked so hard to try to be as perfect as she could be, thinking that if she was perfect, that she might be more loved and accepted. Anne thinks that all of this has been what made it, and still makes it, hard to really accept how she looks, even today. When she described this difficult confrontation with her mother, I could only imagine the amount of tension they each must have felt, and through how she described it, I got a profound glimpse into how alone in her life she must have felt for so long. Her mother was there, but not there. Her mother loved her, but never protected or defended her. As we kept talking, Anne remembered the few things her mother ever said about her own body and that she wasn't totally silent. Her mom would say things like, "I wish I could get rid of this stomach." What sticks out to me about Anne's story is that in spite of her mother's silence about the abuse, her mother was still able to be vocal about her own body shame. Their relationship, like so many mother-daughter relationships, is one of contradictions and complex ironies. And I believe that these contradictions are related and tell a story about what it is like to be us on the inside. Some things are too terrifying to name, but other things, often our displeasure with ourselves and our bodies as women, flow freely from our lips. But Anne made a choice. She chose to be fierce and to do her best to change the way she lived out the mother-daughter relationship so that she didn't hurt her daughters in the ways her mother hurt her. She worked hard to be more emotionally present, vocal, and active in Kelsey's life. She spoke a lot with me about being intentional, about helping Kelsey feel loved, secured, and protected in ways that her own mother was never able to do. When I asked her about the messages she might have communicated to Kelsey about bodies, beauty, and womanhood, she acknowledged that she was probably critical of herself in front of Kelsey. Although she struggled to remember, there were times when she remembers saying things like, "I have nothing nice to wear. This outfit doesn't look good." Or her recent frustration to find clothes that fit her well so that she likes her body as it is changing through menopause. When I asked Anne about what she might have communicated to her kids without trying, she became quite tentative and said that she always took pride in her appearance and might have communicated to Kelsey that women should look a certain way, and that it was not good to be seen out in sweatpants, that as a woman, you can't let yourself go.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.